I'm Old Sneelock. Welcome to another episode of Old Sneelock's Workshop. I have a hole to drill, and I want to drill it with this drill bit. This drill bit is pretty well screwed up. The tip has been broken and it's rusty, and like most of the stuff that I get, it's in pretty bad shape. All I have to do is sharpen it, and that's a quick enough thing to do. I can do it by hand. There's lots of machines that you can buy, but I do them by hand because it's quick and simple, and that's what I'm all about. I like to have a lot of light. As I get older, my eyes aren't as good as they used to be, so I like to have a lot of light on where I'm working. The other thing I want to do is protect my hearing. I'm already wearing hearing aids, which when I'm doing something like this, I turn them off. But I also put on hearing protection, because what little bit I got left, I want to keep. And I'm wearing safety glasses. First thing I want to do is dress the wheel and square it off. Now, I use one of these bricks. It's less expensive than the fancier diamond tools. And also, I think I get a flatter edge because I'm able to track it a little better with this stone. With a single point diamond, I can track it across and do a fairly good job of cutting it straight. But with this, it's gonna average out and end up with a flatter surface. Now with the grinder unplugged, I'm gonna check the wheel. What this stone does is it breaks down the surface of the wheel and makes it so that the sharp grains are exposed. It also trues up the wheel. See this little spot right here? That's the spot where the wheel is worn deeper than what it is over here. And I want to have this wheel completely round. I'm going to plug the grinder back in. And I'm just tracking the stone across the face of the wheel. You never want to jam a wheel. If you try and stop the wheel so that you can see it sooner, good chance you'll break it. Now with the grinder unplugged again, you can see that the surface of the wheel is all consistent now. That's going to do a couple things for me. One, it's going to make the wheel sharp, so it'll cut freer. A wheel that's sharp and cuts freer doesn't heat up the part as much because it's slicing the material away instead of rubbing it. The other thing it does is it makes it round so that as I'm holding this drill bit up there, it's not bouncing. So I end up with a better, smoother cut. The other thing I want to do after I dress the wheel, I want to adjust the guards on it. I want to have the tool rest within an eighth of an inch of the wheel. I like to have it a little closer. I don't want to have it rubbing, but I want to definitely have it so that anything I'm grinding is not going to get caught and trapped in between the tool rest and the wheel. And then I want to take and move the spark shield down so it's close to the wheel.
Both of these should be within an eighth of an inch. I like to run them closer than that. I like to have them as close as I can get them when not rubbing. The idea behind these, the tool rest performs two functions. One, while I'm grinding, it lets me hold the drill bit. And in this case, I'm going to put my hand on it and use it as a tool rest that way. But it also stops the wheel from pulling my hand down so that I have a much better chance of getting a good cut. The spark stop up here, the upper shield, keeps the sparks from flying around and hitting me, but it also performs a more important function. Both it and the tool rest contain the wheel inside this casting. If something happens and this wheel shatters, I want to have as much as possible stay inside this iron casting, because if this wheel does shatter, the pieces can fly out with tremendous force and I don't want to get hit with them. If you're careful and do what you're supposed to do, these wheels are very strong. You can't beat on them, but they'll take everyday use all day long, wearing them down to the point where there's nothing left. But you just have to take care of them. Now we're going to determine what the tip angle should be. In the Machinist Ready reference, compiled by C. Weingartner, for machinist toolmakers, apprentices, and designers. In up-to-date drilling practice, drilling different grades of materials requires, at times, a modification of the commercial 118-degree drill point for maximum results. Hard materials require a blunter point with a more acute angle for softer materials. For the average class of work, you'd use a 118-degree included angle and a 12 to 15-degree lip clearance. That refers to figure 1 and 2, which is over here. The 118-degree included angle, referenced in the text, refers to 118 degrees included between this lip and that lip. So it amounts to a 59.5-degree angle from the center line to that, and then another one, 59.5 degrees, from the center line to this side. Add the two together, you come up with 118. Now, the lip clearance refers to the back angle, or relief angle as some people call it, on the drill bit. That's the angle that allows the back surface of the cutting edge to clear the material that it's cutting. On this drill, we can see that there's a 59 degree angle here and a 59 degree angle here. Included angle is 118 degrees. When we come over to this side, you can see that this surface is lower than the point of the bit. That makes sense. If you want to use a jackknife to cut a piece of wood, you don't lay the bit. If you want to use a jackknife to cut a piece of wood, you don't lay the blade down flat and try and scrub down in. You have to give it an angle. You have to give it an angle so that the blade can sink into the wood. Flat, angled. We want to do the same thing with the drill bit. We want to give it an angle so that as the bit cuts through the wood, it cuts like the jackknife does. If we had it flat, all it would do is rub. If we're cutting softer material, we want to have anywhere from a 90 to 130 degree included angle. This bit is ground at 105 degrees. You can see the difference between the two bits. This one is for drilling brass. This one is for drilling steel. This one, although badly sharpened, is set up to drill wood. It has a much sharper angle on it.
The other thing I need is a source of some water. I want to be able to cool off that drill bit as I'm grinding on it. Okay, hearing protection's in place. I'm standing in front of the wheel. I have the tool rest adjusted, I have the upper guard adjusted, and I have the wheel dressed. I think we're ready to go.
With the grinder unplugged, I'm going to walk you through what I did. By holding the drill bit between the thumb and forefinger of my right hand, I was able to use that as a steady rest to hold the drill bit up against the grinding wheel at the proper angle. Now, for me, it's gotten to the point where I just naturally do that. I know how to hold a 118 degree included angle just by looking at it. There are tools that you can use to verify that you have the proper angle. If you're within a degree or two, you're close enough. Then, with the drill bit held securely in my right hand, I use my left hand to rock the drill bit up and down. Because what I want to do is I want to touch and I want to grind until I see that this edge is striking sparks off the backside. In other words, the sparks that are coming off the wheel are actually tracking down in through the groove in the drill bit. When I see the sparks coming off this side of the drill bit, I know that I have the drill dressed down to the point where I'm actually sharpening it. Now, once I've got those sparks showing, then I'm going to rock the drill bit up. At the same time holding the drill bit against the wheel, I'm just going to lower the back end and let it ride up the wheel. By doing it this way, I'm not plunging the drill bit into it. The drill bit is able to ride on my hand and ride up the wheel, and that allows it to cut the relief angle on the back. And it lets you run a pretty smooth angle on the back here too. You don't want to have this all rough and scalloped. You want to have it a nice smooth angle. Because this drill bit was broken off, I had to take off quite a bit. Typically, it's just going to be zip, zip. Just take the drill bit, go up, check and make sure it's centered. We want to make sure that the center of that drill bit, the conical point between the two surfaces, is dead center on the drill bit. What that does, that center point is the bearing that the drill bit rides on when it's doing the cutting. If it's off to one side or the other, the drill bit orbits and it drills a hole that's larger than the diameter of the drill bit. We want to have that point exactly in the center of the drill bit. By setting the drill bit against the scale, I can say, okay, I'm centered on that drill bit. My point is in the proper place. My relief angle is 15 degrees. And I now have a sharp drill bit. Once you've gone through that a few times, it gets a lot easier. Hitting the 59 degrees becomes just a matter of muscle memory. With minimum setup, you can sharpen your own drill bits. Doesn't take but a couple of seconds, and you don't have to go through all the steps every time. Once you've set up your grinder, and you've got the tool rest in the proper position, you got the upper guard set right, you've got the wheel dressed. Dressing the wheel for the average guy is gonna be something that they do only after they do some rough grinding. And this grinding wheel, I typically don't do any rough grinding on. I set it up purposely so that I'd be able to show you what happens when you dress the wheel. You shouldn't have to have a fancy drill bit sharpener, and you don't have to spend the time, effort, and money learning how to use one of those fancy drill bit sharpeners, because by the time you've done all that, you can learn to sharpen a drill bit on your own. If you have any suggestions for a new video, questions about today's video, or any of the other videos on the channel, just drop a note in the comments below. You know, I read them all. Thanks for watching.